Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever applies to wherever you are. My name is Martijn Marsman and I'm at the University of Vienna and I've been there since 2001, working on and with the VASP code in the group of Professor Georg Kresse. The second part of my affiliation, as you might see here, is the VASP software company. Since about a year, everything related to developing and maintaining of VASP has been spun off out of the university into the VASP software company, which is still very closely associated to the university and to a large part owned by the University of Vienna. And since about half a year, the VASP software company has started to distribute VASP 6. And this webinar will focus on total energies beyond DFT, which in itself, strictly speaking, is not new to VASP 6. But the way this is implemented in VASP 6 is vastly different from the way it was in previous versions. And I will explain how and why and what advantages this offers. This is the outline of today's webinar. I'll introduce the need to go beyond DFT and hybrid functionals. Normally, I present hybrid functionals as a first step beyond DFT, but in the interest of time, I will lump them together and show you that there's a need to go beyond DFT and hybrid functional theory. That step beyond will be the random phase approximation, and I will spend some time explaining what that is. And then I'll come to the thing that is new in VASP 6, and that is the cubic scaling implementation of the random phase approximation. And there we'll discuss cubic scaling, random phase approximation, total energies, and quasi-particles. And I will come to speak about frequency and time integration grids, because there's a lot of work put into VASP 6 to make these calculations efficient by choosing clever frequency and time integration grids. Well, if time allows, and I fear it won't, I will say some words about forces in the random phase approximation. But as I tend to go over time always, I fear that we will not be able to come to that part. Okay, so on this slide, I try to summarize why there is a need to go beyond density functional theory and hybrid functional theory in the description of electronic correlation. So the first point to make is a positive one, and that is shown in this particular graph, where the blue dots are band gaps computed in density functional theory with the PBE functional, and they strongly underestimate experiment, which is the red line. But going to a hybrid functional, for instance, this HSE functional, you see there's a huge improvement. And especially for small to medium gap systems, hybrid functional theory is very satisfactory. When there are some compounds where it fails, and especially going to larger gap systems, hybrid functional theory runs into trouble. But the bad news in terms of DFT and hybrid functional theory is the fact that we are not able to predict total energy differences with what is called chemical accuracy. So the accuracy that we are after is to be able to predict these total energy differences like atomization or formation energies and reaction barriers with something like 1 kcal per mole. And we cannot do that with DFT or with hybrid functional theory. Another point, another thing that is completely missing in density functional theory and in hybrid functional theory are van der Waals interactions. So I will show you one example that nicely shows problems that DFT and hybrid functional theory have. And I will be returning to this particular example when we discuss the random phase approximation. And that particular example is the CO adsorb the adsorption of carbon monoxide on d-metallic surfaces. And what is wrong with the DFT description of this particular problem? And that is that DFT incorrectly predicts that carbon monoxide would prefer to adsorb on a hollow side, so an FCC or an HCP hollow side, whereas in experiment it is clear that it adsorbs on top. And this error, the error that that you get in this site preference is relatively large. So depending on what particular surface CO adsorbs on, this is something between 50 and 100 or 200 millielectron volt, which is quite a bit. The reason for this problem in DFT is shown here, and that is that the gap between the highest occupied molecular orbital of carbon monoxide and the lowest unoccupied one is too small in DFT. Like these band gaps were too small, these homo-lumo gaps are also too small, and that is the difference between this 2 pi star you see here and this 1 pi, for instance. Experiment is those are those yellow brackets, so it is too small, and that leads to a too strong interaction of this 2 pi star hybridization of this orbital with the metallic d states, and that leads to a preference for adsorption in the FCC site. So basically what we see here is that DFT is not doing very well for these molecular systems with localized electrons. It does quite well for the metal, but not for the molecule. So when we now move to include results obtained with hybrid functional theory, and that is what we see here. So for CO on copper, rhodium, and platinum, and we have PbE and two hybrid functionals, PbE0 and HSE. And we see all the numbers in red are those where the site preference is wrong. So CO on copper in PbE would adsorb on an FCC hollow site, on rhodium on an HCP hollow site, on platin again on an FCC hollow site. Well, hybrid functional theory repairs this in a few cases. So those are the numbers in blue. Those are correct predictions. So it adsorbs on top on copper and on rhodium, but not on platinum. So it's not a systematic improvement. Furthermore, and that is one other thing that you should look at here, is that the absolute adsorption energies are hugely overestimated, right? These are the experimental numbers, and they are sometimes overestimated by a factor of 2. And this is what I mentioned before, that those energy differences simply come out wrong with DFT, but also with hybrid function theory. So yes, there is a need to go beyond that. So why does this not come out right using hybrid functional theory? Because what we know from hybrid functional theory is that, for instance, the description of a CO molecule should be hugely improved compared to DFT. Well, that is what you see here. So if we look at the red line, we see that the gap between the 2 pi star orbital and 1 pi is almost in complete agreement with experiment. The problem here, however, is that the description of the hybrid functional for the metallic states is not good. And again, then the thing suffers from the same problem, that there's a too strong hybridization between the LUMO of CO and the metallic D states, because the D metal bandwidth comes out too large when using the hybrid functional. So now we have, if you so want, a vice versa problem. We do describe the molecule well with the hybrid functional, but not the metal. So we don't have a systematic improvement. We don't have a functional that is equally valid for all bonding situations. So there is a definite need to go to a more sophisticated description of electronic correlation. And that will be in the talk of today, that will be the random phase approximation. And this random phase approximation will come up in two different contexts. It will be mentioned in the or shown in the context of quasi-particles from GW. That is electronic structure, if you so want, in the random phase approximation. And that's the main topic of today, total energies from the adiabatic connection fluctuation dissipation theorem within the RPA. And I will show you that both of them are actually related in ways that that you might know from DFT and hybrid functional theory. So what is shown here is essentially the escalation of complexity when we go from DFT to hybrid functional theory and then on to quasi-particles and so GW and the ACFDT. So, and the complexity can be understood as follows. So this rising complexity in DFT, the exchange and correlation, so all quantum mechanical nature of electrons is carried by this local potential, and it's a functional of only the density. When we move to hybrid functionals, we see that we get a different, a more complex object, which is this exchange potential shown here, which is non-local, so it depends on R and R prime. And not only that, it's a functional not only of the density, but of the occupied orbitals. And when we move to GW and to quasi-particle picture, and we go from this this exchange operator to this one, which is called the self-energy, and that is even more complicated. So as arguments, it's non-local. You see these arguments R and R prime, but it also depends on an energy argument, and it's a functional of all orbitals, so not only the occupied ones, and all eigenenergies. So yes, so that is, if you so want, the escalation of complexity that you see here. And it will come as no surprise that as you go from DFT to hybrid functionals to quasi-particles, computational effort increases quite a bit. So this self-energy that you have seen here in the GW approximation, that self-energy is determined by a Green's function and the screened Coulomb potential. And I've written it out here explicitly. So basically in the frequency domain as it is written here, you see that it is actually a convolution between a Green's function at omega and a screened Coulomb interaction. And here you see a dielectric screening that is also frequency dependent. You see here that this Green's function runs over all orbitals. Well, all orbitals is of course something that in practice doesn't get used, but this is already something to show you that in fact we are going to we will have to go beyond simply determining orbitals for the occupied states. There's a number of unoccupied orbitals needed as well to represent this Green's function. And if you compare that, for instance, to Fock exchange, then you see that actually the form is very similar. So this self-energy is often called a screened exchange operation. You see here these combinations of one electron orbitals at R and R prime. You see that here as well. Here you see a bare Coulomb interaction, and here it's a screened one. And of course here there's a convolution over the frequency. But in essence, the self-energy in GW is of this form of a screened exchange operator. And in the case of Fock exchange, the sum over these orbitals only includes the occupied ones. So that is quite a bit less computationally demanding than what you see here. So the Green's function, as I've written it here, why have I written it out here? Basically to show you that we can construct this out of the quantities that we more or less already know from DFT, one electron orbitals and eigenenergies and those kind of things. We are used to computing those in DFT, and those are the ingredients that we need to compute the Green's function. Then there's another ingredient that we need, and that is of course this dielectric screening that will be have to be determined as well. But before we go into that, we can maybe spend a few minutes on the Green's function itself and its, and its physical interpretation. So, because the Green's function has a quite a clear physical interpretation. So a Green's function at R and R prime and T prime describes the propagation of a particle from position R at time T to position R prime at time T prime. So in other words, if I have a particle at position R at time T, the Green's function tells me the probability to find this particle at R prime at a different time T prime. Yeah. It looks a bit different here because of this has been Fourier transformed. And this depends only on the time difference between T and T prime. So when you Fourier transform it, you only get one frequency argument. And this is actually the expression for the Green's function in the frequency domain. We can also write it directly in the time domain. That is done here. In that case, there's also a nice way to represent it by means of these diagrams, of these lines. This is a propagator for a particle from position one at time one to position two at time two. And the mathematical object is given here in the time domain. And that is going to be of some consequence because previous implementations of WASP basically used definitions of the Green's function in the frequency domain, and in WASP 6, we rely on representations of the Green's function in the time domain, and that has some advantages that I will show you later. So that is enough for on the Green's function for now. There was this other for the GW. There was this other property that we still needed to determine, and that was the dielectric screening. So the key ingredient in computing the dielectric screening is the irreducible polarizability in the independent particle picture. And that's quite a bit of a mouthful. It's often shortened as chi zero or chi naught. I will mostly call it chi naught. And chi naught is in fact the first order change in the Kohn-Sham density induced by a change in the effective Kohn-Sham potential. And I will show you later that we can compute this particular thing out of the quantities that you know, one electron orbitals and one electron energies. So this is something that we can get out of our density functional calculations. And what is now so nice is that in the RPA, so in the random phase approximation, because this is the point where the random phase approximation comes in, the screened Coulomb interaction can be computed in terms of this chi naught. And it's given here, so it's a geometrical series. And what goes in is this chi naught that we can compute and the Baer-Coulomb interaction. So in the physical interpretation of this geometrical series is as follows. So the first term in this series is the Baer-Coulomb interaction. So if a particle travels through a medium, it interacts with its environment through electrostatic interactions, and that is basically represented by this Baer-Coulomb interaction. The second term represents the following process. And the particle that propagates through a medium interacts with this medium electrostatically, and it induces a change in the density around it. And the change in the density around it that it induces is given by chi naught times nu. And this change in the density then gives rise to a change in the Hartree potential that the particle experiences. And that is nu chi naught nu. So that's the second term. And the third term is that this induced change in the Hartree potential, which was nu chi naught nu, induces a further change in the density, which is chi naught nu. And this in turn changes the Hartree potential again, which is nu chi naught nu. Well, this goes on and on and on. So, and if you sum all these possible terms, then you end up with this particular result. So the nice thing is that for this particular kind of series, we know the limit. and we can compute it because the ingredient that goes in is this this chi zero that we can compute out of our density functional theory. So the random phase approximation, so the reason that we like the random phase approximation is that it's conveniently computable, right? So products of chi naught and nu are easily computable. And of course it's an approximation because particles that travel through a medium don't interact with their environments only electrostatically. They also have exchange interactions and so on. But this approximation is less severe than you might think because electrostatic interactions are quite strong. So that's basically the second reason that we like this approximation, is that it yields useful results because it's a dominant part of the interaction of a particle traveling through a medium. So this is the essence of the random phase approximation. And that is the way that we compute our screened Coulomb operator out of this irreducible polarizability. So, right, I said that we can compute this from quantities that are readily obtainable from density functional theory calculations, and that is essentially shown here, because chi naught. So what I've shown here is an expression for chi naught that was derived somewhere in the 60s by Adler and Weiser. And you see here what goes in are one electron orbitals and one electron energies. So things that we can get out of DFT calculations. Another thing that you might see here is that there's a sum over virtual states, over empty states, and a sum over occupied states. And the fact that we here have to include virtual, so empty states as well, already shows you that this will be expensive in some way. So there's a nice diagrammatic representation of chi naught, and that is this one. So it's a product of two Green's functions of a particle propagator and the Hall propagator, and that is written here. Again, now in the time domain, it's a simple product of two Green's functions, and that is going to be of some importance later on, because we are going to be using that. Like I said, we are going to use the Green's function in the time domain, and we're going to use it to compute chi naught in a way that is different from what Adler and Weiser have shown us in the 60s. And these, because of their shape, these things are called polarization bubbles. And the screened Coulomb interaction in the random phase approximation can then be depicted like this, as this series of these connected polarization bubbles. And these wiggly lines denote the bare Coulomb interaction. So, when we combine that, so these lines that you see here and a bubble and these two lines, they represent in essence a W. And we said that a line like this is a Green's function. So to represent the product of G and W would be to multiply each of these things that make up the screened Coulomb interaction with the Green's function. So this is a pictorial representation of the GW. It's not crucial to understand it, it's nice, it's elegant, but I will come back to it to show the connection between total energies in the random phase approximation and electronic structure in the random phase approximation. Because until now we have been, I have been speaking about this GW equation, and that is essentially a way to do electronic structure, like solving the Cohn-Sham equation basically gives you a spectral representation of your eigenvalues, which is the electronic structure. In GW, get quasi-particle energy. So this is the electronic structure in the random phase approximation, if you so want. But the actual topic of this webinar is total energies in the random phase approximation. You could now ask yourself, is there a total energy expression that belongs to GW the way that the DFT total energy belongs to the Cohn-Sham equations and the way the Hartree-Fock energy belongs to the Rotan equations? And yes, there is, and that total energy expression in the random phase approximation is given here. It contains many things that you know, so a Kohn-Sham kinetic energy and a Hartree energy and an exchange, a Fock exchange energy with DFT orbitals. And there's one new thing here, and that is this EC, and that is the RPA correlation energy. You can derive this correlation energy using the adiabatic connection fluctuation dissipation theorem. And that is why it's often called ACFDT total energy or ACFDT RPA, for instance. And the fact that we are in this random phase approximation, that becomes more clear when we take this argument of the logarithm, so of the trace here, and write it as a series. And if you write it as a series, then again we see that essentially this is made up of products of chi naught nu, and to third order and to fourth order and so on, just like we saw in case of our screening in GW in the random phase approximation. And again, of course, this chi naught is the change in the Kohn-Sham density with respect to a change in the effective potential. So the diagrammatic representation of this ACFDT correlation energy is shown here. And to sort of hand-wavingly show you why the GW and this total energy expression belong together, we can take the derivative of this total energy with respect to a Green's function. And that means that we, in this case, we remove one of these propagator lines, so an upwards going line in this case, so this one, this one, this one. And then you see that these diagrams actually transform in the ones that make up the GW. And this particular connection, so the derivative of an energy with respect to a Green's function will be the self-energy in GW. That is the same connection that you have when you take the derivative of the of, for instance, the Hartree-Fock energy and take the derivative of that with respect to the Green's function, then you end up with the Fock potential. And in DFT, if you take the DFT total energy and take the derivative with the Green's function, with respect to a Green's function, then you end up with the DFT, with the effective potential. Okay, so these belong together in exactly the same way that DFT total energy and the Kohn-Sham equations belong together. So we have spent a lot of time characterizing the random phase approximation, and here I will show you some results, and I hope to convince you that it's a very useful approximation. Well, here we have studied lattice constants for a whole bunch of materials, wide gap insulators, semiconductors, metals, and what we essentially see here, and that is the red line, is that the deviation with respect to experiment is very small, and it is smaller than in most cases density functional theory or Hartree-Fock will give you. And let's not forget those methods are already very good at describing lattice constants. Moreover, what one sees here is that the random phase approximation performs quite well for all classes of systems, so wide gap insulators, but also for metals, which for instance would not be the case for Hartree-Fock. A very strong point to make for the random phase approximation is that it incorporates van der Waals interactions to a certain degree. And that is hopefully convincingly shown here for a case of noble gas solids, which are almost solely van der Waals bound. So here we see the dependence of the correlation energy on the volume for krypton, argon, and neon. Essentially, they depend on the square of the volume, and linearly depend on the square of the volume, which is what you would expect for a van der Waals interaction. And from this, you can compute C6 coefficients of these van der Waals interactions and compare them directly to experiment. And especially using PVE orbitals, in the random phase approximation get a very close agreement for this quantity with respect to experiment. If you look at the equilibrium volume of crystalline argon, then we see that the random phase approximation, which is this red line, is almost spot on with respect to experiment. And even the cohesive energy is quite well predicted in this case. So that is a very, very nice thing to have. Van der Waals interactions, for the first time, if you so want, a part of, natively part of the functional that we are using. Here we see a comparison between a partly van der Waals bonded solid and a covalent solid. So this is the equilibrium volume of diamond versus graphite. So we see that the equilibrium structure is almost perfectly predicted using the RPA. So not only the volume in this case, but if you look at the interlayer distance in graphite, we see that it's almost exactly spot on with experiment. If you look at elasticity constants along that direction, the RPA is also in very good agreement with experiment, and even the binding interlayer binding energy comes out very close to experiment. The dependence of this interlayer binding energy in graphite goes with 1/d^4, as is shown here, where d is the interlayer distance, and that is exactly what you would expect for layered compounds at medium distance, for van der Waals interactions between conducting sheets at medium distance. So the one little note of unhappiness that we have here is the fact that the atomization energies of these two systems do not agree very well with experiment. So that would be the minimum, the difference between the minimum here and the little squares. And those squares have already been raised by 0.3 EV. So those differences are quite large. So unfortunately, we are not looking at a functional that will give us chemical accuracy in that respect. But what we do see is that the atomization energies of these compounds are they're almost degenerate. And that is what you would see in experiment as well. So a lot of things are very nice, but it's not the complete solution yet, unfortunately. And that is shown here as well for heats of formation. So heats of formation for some of these elemental reactions shown for the RPA compared to experiment, we see that these differences are still too large. So a kilojoule per mole is something like a quarter of a kcal per mole. But even with that, we are still several kcal per mole away from experiment in the RPA. The good thing is that the RPA does reasonably, that gives a reasonable result for all these reactions. So it's not the best result for each and every reaction when we compare to PVE and Hartree-Fock, but it's consistently doing reasonably well. So it's a very well balanced functional in that respect. So when we then go and revisit our example of before, that was the CO adsorption on d-metallic surfaces, and that there we saw that we have problems in DFT and we have problems in hybrid functional theory, and now we'll have a look what happens in the random phase approximation. Well, first I show a slightly different a graph here than I showed before. So here we compare two predictions, actually, a prediction for the surface energy of the metallic surface and the adsorption energy of CO on at the top side of rhodium and platinum. And we see, and that we do for using a hybrid functional and several density functionals. And what we see is that all these functionals land on these lines. Yeah, so if I use PVE, I get this result for surface energy and adsorption energy. If I move to PVE sol, I move along this dashed line. And the same thing basically for rhodium. The unfortunate thing is that even though there's a huge dependence of on the functional, the experimental points are here. So moving along these lines doesn't get us near to these points. So either we can choose a functional that gives us a very good absorption energy, but then our surface energy will be very wrong, or vice versa. So that is, and that's a very strange combination, because what we see here is that they these functionals combine an underestimation of the surface energy with an overestimation of the adsorption energy. And that is strange, because if you underestimate a surface energy, then you're basically saying the surface is very happy to be a surface. But if it at the same time overestimates the absorption energy, then in fact, it's too happy to bind something. So and that would be a sign that it's that it would very much like to be something different than a surface. Anyway, when we go to the RPA results, we see that we move orthogonally to these dashed lines, and we move actually towards experiment, especially for rhodium. So for CO on rhodium, we get a very, very nice agreement with experiment. We think that this the surface energy in experiment for platin might actually should actually move a bit in direction of our computed result. We are very proud of our computed result and believe that there is still some uncertainty in the experiment as well that would move it towards our prediction. Surface energies are very difficult to measure accurately. So basically, why are we now moving to experiment? And that is shown here. So we had this trouble that in DFT, we had a good description of the metallic surface, but not of the carbon monoxide molecule. In the hybrid functional, we had a good description of the carbon monoxide states, but not so much of the density of the metallic states. But now here in GW, we see that we do quite well for this 2π star orbital, a bit less so for the HOMO levels, but we also at the same time do quite well for the metallic states. And so we have a well-balanced description that is able to deal with these two extremes. It can describe a molecule satisfactorily, but also a metal at the same time. And that then sort of drops everything in place, because then we get the right side preference that is shown here below. We even get very good absorption energies, very close to experiment, almost all are within the experimental error brackets. And we get excellent lattice constants for the bulk metals that is shown here. The black line is PbE sol, that's doing very well as well, density functional for something like this. And we get very good surface energies, almost on top of experiment as well, as far as that goes with surface energies. So yes, for the first time, we have a functional that does well for all these particular aspects of this problem, for the molecule as well as for the metal. So I hope that that this makes a strong case for the usefulness of the random phase approximation. It was already implemented in VASP in the previous versions, so in VASP 5 versions, but those suffered from of a particular drawback, and that was that computing that is this central quantity, this chi naught, this irreducible particle polarizability, that scaled as n to the power 4, where n is a measure of system size. So I'm not going to go into detail, but if you evaluate this particular object in frequency space, as we used to do, this scales as n to the power 4. And that, of course, is a serious burden, and it prevents you from doing useful things on larger systems. So we have put in a lot of work to change this, and the solution or the route that we took is that we will start with evaluating the Green's function in imaginary time. So not in frequency, but in time, in imaginary time, if you so want. And that is something that scales cubically. So computing this object scales cubically. Then the computing the polarizability is a simple point-by-point product of two Green's functions, one at a time t and one at time minus t. And that scales quadratically. So if you evaluate chi naught in this manner, it doesn't scale as n to the power 4, but n to the power 2. Then you can do a cosine transform to get in the frequency domain where we need this particular object. That's okay to do. And then we can evaluate the ACFTT expression for the RPA correlation energy, exactly like we did before. And evaluating this scales as n to the power 3. So in total, we have now an algorithm that scales cubically instead of n to the power 4 in its worst scaling steps. One point is that storing quantities and their intermediates for g and for chi is very expensive, and we need to choose small and cleverly chosen sets of these time and frequency points to end up with a tractable scheme. And that is where really a lot of effort has gone into in VASP 6. And the solution that we have implemented rests on the minimax fit. And I will quickly explain to you what the minimax fit is. So we can express a function. Basically what we want to do is we want to express a function f of x in basis functions, or fitted by these basis functions, phi, such that the error that we make, and that is given here, is as small as possible. Well, small is as possible is a matter of definition. And in the for the minimax fit, you choose the parameters that you fit with, so beta and alpha. You choose them so that the maximum error is minimized. That is the minimax fit. And this particular solution, so this particular set of coefficients, is then called the minimax solution to that particular fitting problem. So how can you use this to construct suitable frequency and time grids? And that's as follows. So first we write the frequency-dependent polarizability in a way that clearly shows its dependence on the frequency. Those are these functions here, these functions phi of the frequency and of a variable x, and this variable x is essentially an energy difference between one electron and x. So what we then do with this minimax problem is to determine a frequency grid and quadrature weights that best fits this particular energy expression. And this is the first term actually in this series expansion of the RPA correlation energy. And it's called the second order direct Müller-Plessett energy, but it's the first term in this correlation expansion. And we fit it with these basis functions, the ones that you see here, in the minimax sense. Well, the exact shape the minimax problem then takes is shown here. And we want to we want now to determine quadrature weights gamma and frequencies omega in such a way that this particular error, the maximum of this error, is minimized over a certain range of x, and that is taken from the band gap to the maximum energy difference between two 1-electron orbitals we have in our set. And that can be done with a Ramez algorithm. And once you have that, you can write this particular integral over frequency as a sum, as a quadrature sum with weights gamma and frequencies omega. And so we get a frequency grid out of this and quadrature weights. We can do exactly the same thing in the time domain that is written here. So the only thing really is that these functions, these basis functions, are now other ones than in the frequency domain. Otherwise, it's exactly the same kind of procedure. So the one thing that then still is missing is the way that we can transform between the two, from between the frequency and the time domain, because that is what we need to do with this polarizability, as I showed you on one of the previous slides. Well, normally that would be on a regular grid, that would be a regular cosine transform, as is shown here above. And we have now these non-uniform minimax grids. And for this, we define a non-uniform cosine transform. And basically, it's a linear transformation from one domain to the other. And the weights that go into this linear transformation are of this particular form. And we determine them again by means of a minimax fit. So we determine an optimal set of weights for this particular transformation between the time points and the frequency points that we also get from the minimax solution. So how well do these grids work? That is basically the point that we are after. And that is the nice news is that they work very well. So we see here for zinc oxide and silicon, we see the error that is made, the absolute error in the correlation energy as a function of the number of points in this grid. And we see that with 16 points, we are somewhere at 10 to the minus 10 EV error in the correlation energy. So somewhere between 12 and 16 points is you get a super representation of the correlation energy. So these grids are really, really very sparse. And can't compare this to regular grids in frequency that we used to use in previous versions. So the only difference between the pink line and the blue line is that for the blue line, the calculation runs completely in the frequency domain, whereas for the pink line, we use this cubic scaling algorithm where there is a transformation from the time to the frequency domain involved. This was this non-uniform cosine transform. We basically see that the results do not differ. So this non-uniform cosine transform is very accurate as well. So if you do the RPA total energy calculations this way, with the new RPA code implemented in WASP 6, your computational effort scales linearly with the number of K points that you use and cubically in system size. And inherently, that's the same scaling as our DFT implementation, because orthogonalizing the wave functions in DFT is also a cubic scaling operation. But of course, the prefactors are much, much larger than in DFT. So linear scaling with respect to K points is shown here. And a cubic scaling with respect to system size is shown in this table. So basically for 50, for 120 and 250 silicon atoms, we see that the time scores per atoms to the power 3 is basically a constant. And we see another nice thing, that running an RPA calculation on 250 atoms on 128 cores takes about 300 seconds in this case. So it's really quite a tractable way of doing business. Of course, this will depend on the size of the number of electrons that you put in. So number of atoms, actually should say number of electrons in the system. But of course, that scales with system size as well. So just to show you a real world application of this, we have computed the defect formation energies of a few common defects in silicon, a dumbbell interstitial, and the hollow interstitial and a tetragonal interstitial and a vacancy, a Jan Teller distorted vacancy. And we compare this these formation energies in the RPA to high quality quantum Monte Carlo data. And what we again see here is that we do not reach chemical accuracy in an absolute sense, but our relative energies, our relative formation energies, agree very nicely with quantum Monte Carlo data for all of the defects. And that is not the case per se for density functional theory and for hybrid functional theory. And definitely not for hybrid functional theory combined with van der Waals interactions. So a very well balanced balanced functional and a very nice algorithm with that actually allows you to do useful things, because these unit cells that were used for these problems, they are something like 250 atoms large. So that would have been completely impossible with our previous implementation of this particular formalism. So the way that we run the calculations is still very similar to what we did before. So we start with the DFT ground state calculation for a small, and we get a small set of orbitals. Then we have to generate a number of empty states at the DFT level as well. That's the second calculation where we basically do an exact diagonalization of the Hamiltonian. We do it one time and we restart from the density from this particular calculation or from their wave functions that define the density, and then do one exact diagonalization. We mostly set the number of bands to the maximum number of plane waves. So that means that you determine all possible bands for that particular Hamiltonian. And that we then feed into the RPA calculation. So, and now we use a very, very small number of grid points. So something between 12 and 16 should already be very excellent, where I think our previous algorithm would use something like 50 or 100 grid points at least. So another nice thing is that you can get around doing this in three different steps with WASP 6. If you do not specify end bands at the start of a calculation, if you basically use an INCAR of this particular type shown here, then WASP will run all these consecutive steps in one go. So it will do the DFT calculation, it will expand the number of states to include a lot of high quality virtual states, and run the RPA calculation immediately afterwards, all in one run. Now, if you want to restrict the number of bands that are used to compute the Green's function, like it on the previous slide, that the role of that would be setting this n bands to a certain number. If you want to do that in this particular case, you can set n bands exact, and that will then specify the number of bands you use in your Green's function. So let's look at an example. Basically, well, it's a very small example. It's only two atoms in the unit cell, 3 by 3 by 3 K points. So this is really a toy system, if you so want. The INCAR, we set ACFTT-R. This is this cubic scaling ACFTT algorithm. We choose 16 frequency points. I've restricted the number of bands to 120, the number of bands that define the Green's function, but this is completely optional. Essentially, well, this I have to include to get optical properties computed as well. And then basically these are some parameters that are used for the density functional calculation. So the type of smearing, so I make sure that it's an insulator, and I converge to a very high level of convergence. So the PODCA files remains the same as before. If you use these methods that rely on empty states as well. So if I include a lot of empty states up to an energy high above the Fermi energy, then we recommend that you use our so-called GW PODCA files, because they not only represent the scattering properties of the atom in the area of the occupied space well, but to much higher energies as well. So much higher up into the virtual space, you get good scattering properties with those potentials as well. And then you run the code. And basically, this is what you are bound to see. So the first part of the output is related to the computation of the DFT ground state, as you are familiar with, probably, in this case, using the Davidson algorithm. Then there's a little block where the exact diagonalization happens. And we expand, and we go from a very limited number of states that are used in the DFT calculation, we go to a much larger number of states. So we expand and compute a lot of states with a lot of empty states as well. Then comes a bit that is related to setting up of these frequency grids and time grids, because they get computed on the fly by the code. Well, we have asked for 16 points, and omega was 16, so we get 16 frequency points, and we get 16 time points out of these minimax solution problems. And what the code also does, it will set a parameter and perform. And this is basically a performance parameter. So the number of time points that the code will handle in parallel is automatically set based on the available memory. So either you specify the available memory per node on your machine by means of a maximum tag. If you don't set it, the code will try to find out from proc meminfo how much memory is available on that particular node, and then it will make a choice for this particular tau par. Because this has a direct consequence for how much memory the code will use. Okay. So as I said, there are two performance determining parameters, and that is how you distribute the work that is done over frequency points and over time points. And that is controlled by this M omega par and N tau par. Well, N tau par is chosen automatically based on the amount of memory that is available, as you don't have to set that. And omega par, you don't have to set yourself either. It will try to spread the work on frequencies around as much as possible. But performance-wise, if you have a choice, it is optimal to create a situation where N tau par and N omega par equals N omega. And basically that you can achieve when there's enough memory to set N tau par to N omega. And when you choose the number of MPI ranks that you use as a multiple of N omega. So basically the memory usage is distributed over nodes. So the more nodes you use, the more memory will be available for this problem. So if you take successive sets of N omega ranks in your problem, then at some point you will reach a spot where N tau par and N omega par can be chosen to be as large as the number of frequency points that are used, and the number of time points that are used in the calculation. So you get some indication of how much memory is used, and you see that this is actually quite a lot. So of course that is also a lot because N tau par is chosen 8 in this case, but you see that this is basically a calculation on two atoms, and it's using 450 megabytes per MPI rank. So these methods really take a lot of memory, but it distributes over nodes. So, and then after running the calculation, you can check your outcar for the result. And what you see there is in your outcar, you will see a block like this where the RPA correlation energy gets extrapolated to the infinite basis set limit. There's a formula that is used for that internally in the code. When you do convergence tests, we advise you to investigate convergence with respect to the cutoff energy and not with respect to ENCAT-GW or ENCAT-GW soft. In the interest of time, I will not go in to what these exactly mean, but you can find descriptions of that in the manual. There are defaults chosen for those two energies that are both related in essence to ENCAT, and we advise you to investigate conversions with respect to this one particular single parameter that you would also converge in DFT calculations. And if possible, try to converge energy differences and not absolute correlation energies. That is the same with DFT. It's better to converge energy differences than absolute total energies, because energy differences tend to converge much more rapidly with respect to these cutoffs than the absolute energies. And then at the bottom or near the bottom of your ATKAR file, you will get the RPA total energy. So either computed with this extrapolated correlation energy or with the one at ENCAPGW. And that is the final result of such a calculation. Almost a bit disappointing. It doesn't look so spectacular at the end of the day, but a lot of work went into get to these numbers, actually. So important tags are listed here, and I will make PDFs out of these slides, and they contain links to our wiki and to the relevant parts of the wiki with respect to cubic scaling RPA calculations. So I guess that that this sort of concludes the time I have for the presentation. I will not continue and go into forces in the random phase approximation, but instead I guess we can go to some questions. So with that, I would very much like to thank you for your attention.